Hello there, good evening. Welcome to Look North, our top story tonight. The Prime Minister names the day of a general election. We'll get reaction from Westminster and a marginal constituency.
Back in 2019, Maltby was one of those places that switched from red to blue. So what do the people of this town think now they've got another chance to have their say?
We'll have reaction from around our region, which will be a key battleground for votes. Also tonight, a family calls for more support for those with ADHD following the death of a 17-year-old from West Yorkshire. Taking an eye off the ball, why a lack of ticket sales to see a West End music star at a local cricket club have organisers stumped. And running into history, a Malta woman becomes the fastest to complete the National Three Peaks Challenge.
Well, what a miserable day it's been. Certainly weather for ducks in Moulton. The cricket at Headingley has been completely washed out. We've still got warnings in place, but what about the next few days? Join me for that detailed forecast.
Okay, thank you for joining us this Wednesday evening. You may have already heard the news that a date has been announced for the general election. Back in 2019, when the country elected a Conservative government led by Boris Johnson, Yorkshire and North Derbyshire were key to their success. Fast forward almost 5 years and all eyes will be on our part of the world once again, with voters in constituencies here crucial to who will win and who will lose. Well, here's the moment the Prime Minister made that announcement.
Earlier today, I spoke with His Majesty the King to request the dissolution of Parliament. The King has granted this request, and we will have a general election on the 4th of July. You must choose in this election who has that plan, who is prepared to take the bold action necessary to secure a better future for our country and our children.
Well, it's going to be a busy 6 weeks. Our political reporter Gemma Dillon was following the announcement. She joins us now. Gemma, it's official. What more do we know?
It is official. Today, Rishi Sunak has ended the months of speculation and questions. He's named the date. We now know it's a snap election, date confirmed for July the 4th. He's always said it would be the second half of the year, so it just about sneaks over the line for that. With any luck, we should have some warm weather as the politicians hit the campaign trail, the opposite, of course, to the 2019 election held in December, which saw the Conservatives win by a landslide 80 seats. It was historic in many ways when seats across the north, the so-called Red Wall seats, which had been held by Labour for generations, turned blue in places like Don Valley, Rother Valley, Bolsover, Penistone and Stocksbridge and Wakefield. This was put down partly to Brexit and Boris Johnson's promise to get it done. Fast forward through Brexit, COVID and a whole host of new party leaders to the more recent by-elections, and there has been a huge swing back to Labour in Yorkshire. In Wakefield in 2022, Labour's Simon Lightwood took the seat from the Conservatives with a 12.7% swing. And in Selby last year, Keir Mather won that seat for Labour with a much bigger swing of 23.7%, overturning a majority of over 20,000. Throw into that the election of a Labour mayor for York and North Yorkshire earlier this month with a majority of 15,000 over the Conservatives, plus Labour mayors were elected in West Yorkshire, South Yorkshire and the East Midlands. Just a note as well, if Labour are to form the next government, they need a swing of about 12% to have a majority, giving Sir Keir Starmer the keys to number 10. But we'll have to wait until July to see if that happens.
Thank you, Gemma. Well, Tom is in one of those former Red Wall seats in Maltby. Tom, what are they seeing there tonight?
Evening, Amy. I only popped in here for a fish supper and I'm leaving with a general election. This is the Blue Whale, a well-known chippy on the corner of the street in Maltby in the Rother Valley constituency. I was here in 2019 when this part of the world famously flipped blue after decades supporting red. Same story just down the road in the Don Valley and the same story just down the road in Bassetlaw. And the government will definitely want to try and hang on here. However, myself and our camera editor spent an hour talking in the rain to people about the prospects for a general election, and here's what people had to say.
I'm not bothered.
Why not? Your chance to vote?
Yeah, well, it's like this. We get them in, they're saying they'll do this, that and other, and not bothered.
It's about time. We might be able to put somebody in charge who actually gives a about the Northerners.
I gotta be honest, I don't really vote or anything, so I really have no stance.
Why don't you vote?
Just personal reasons, which I don't really want to get into.
Well, I think we should have one, really. But I hope Rishi Sunak gets back in, even though this is a Labour, you know, we vote Labour. I hope Rishi gets back.
Why is that?
Well, I think he's trying his best. I mean, I can't see Labour doing any better.
Well, I just think it's 14 years of Tory rule at this point. They've failed on basically everything they ever promised. Labour promised other things. I know a lot of them have been wound back, but I think it's just, we need change, I think, at this point.
So you see, in newsrooms, we get very excited about general elections, but I certainly came back down to earth with a bump out on the streets of Maltby. People were apathetic. People weren't really bothered that there was a chance to vote at a general election. So that's the big question for politicians, not do you want salt and vinegar, it's can you connect with the voters?
Tom, thank you. And yes, I'd like mushy peas on mine, thank you. Let's get some more reaction from North Yorkshire now, which recently elected a Labour mayor. In the last few minutes, our correspondent Spencer Stokes has sent this report from Scarborough.
So a summer election, although feeling far from summery here in Scarborough today. North Yorkshire is interesting. Of course, it's the Prime Minister's backyard. He represents the neighbouring Richmond constituency. But Labour looking for success here following that Selby and Ainsty by-election win where they beat the Conservatives a year ago and then unexpectedly winning the new North Yorkshire mayoral race earlier this month. Here in Scarborough, Sir Robert Goodwill is the sitting Conservative MP with a 10,000 vote majority. Can Labour overturn that at the general election? Well, they haven't done that for 19 years. He's been in place since 2005. If they were to win in a seat like this one here in Scarborough, then I think Labour would be on course for a big general election victory. But a long way to go yet, and a long campaign ahead of us in the run-up to July the 4th, the date of the general election.
We've also been getting reaction to today's announcement from some of our local MPs.
And if you look at the local election results, it is very, very clear that people have had enough of Tory chaos. You know, up and down the country, wherever you look, people have had enough of it. And what we need to concentrate is it's up to us now to go and present our case to the people of Great Britain and to gain that trust and offer them stability. It's up to us to offer that, isn't it? And that's what we'll be doing.
It's very easy to think the grass is always greener, but I would just say that Rishi Sunak and the Conservatives, we have a plan for the country. We are coming out of a tough time. The economy is starting to grow. We will support people, get people into well-paid jobs and support our communities. And just look at the mess that Labour-run councils are causing across our region.
Well, let's flesh out the bones of this, shall we? Professor Matthew Flinders from the University of Sheffield joins us. We were expecting an election, weren't we? But possibly the autumn. Is this date a surprise?
It is a surprise. Earlier this week, I was talking to senior officials in Whitehall. They assured me it was going to be a November general election. And now today's happened.
So why now?
Why now? I think really it's the economy. I think Rishi Sunak was hoping that there would be stronger signs of an economic recovery. They're just not happening. So without an economic recovery on the horizon, it makes sense for the Conservatives to go sooner rather than later. Plus defections, talk of more defections happening. And actually, I think Rishi Sunak is exhausted.
Now, last general election, this was a key battleground. Why will it be again?
Oh, it will be a massive battleground in Yorkshire and Humber, because this was the area where the blue vote really came through in the red wall. Lots of constituencies now, the Dearne Valley, Rother Valley, Ilkley, Keighley, they'll all be under massive threat, even Scarborough, as we've just seen there. Anything under 10, maybe under 15,000 majority is going to be vulnerable to moving back to Labour.
And do you think Keir Starmer can grab back those Red Wall voters?
Well, it's very interesting. The people of Maltby there at the fish and chip shop, absolutely right. The big challenge for the Labour Party is getting people out to vote. Political disaffection. People just don't think the system's fair anymore. Conservative voters are generally very good at voting. Labour voters need a lot more support and encouragement to get out to vote. So that's the key challenge for the Labour Party. Being ahead 30% in the polls is great, but you've got to really make that happen on voting day.
And what does it need to do to convince those Red Wall voters again?
I think there's still a big issue for the Labour Party about the vision thing. What is the message? What is the hope that the Labour Party are offering to the people of Scunthorpe or Selby? At the moment, that message is unclear. The Labour Party are really making a lot of headwind by criticising the Conservatives. Very soon, they're going to have to say with clarity, what are we going to do if we're in government?
Thank you, Matthew. I'm sure it won't be the last time we see you in the next 6 weeks. It's going to be a busy time. Next tonight, now away from politics, a call for change from a family of a teenager who tragically took his own life just 4 weeks ago. Henry Grierson from Brighouse was only 17 when he died. He had attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. It's also known as ADHD. It can make some people restless and impulsive. Henry's family says it's vital that there's better support for people living with the condition. Heidi Tomlinson reports.
It's indescribable, the pain that we're all in. It's horrific. And I just hope that this never happens to any other families because it's too awful to bear as a mum.
Henry Grierson took his own life on the 21st of April. The 17-year-old was a talented rugby player studying business and sport at college, but he was also struggling with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. He'd come off prescribed medication because it made his hands shake and affected appetite, and began taking illegal drugs. He'd also been excluded from college after being involved in a fight.
The night before he died, he took the car and he collected some friends. He was pulled over by the police. The police basically impounded the car and they just left him there. And he met up with a friend, eventually came home, and then he wrote his suicide note.
West Yorkshire police say Henry declined the offer of being taken home and made his own way back. The case was referred to the Independent Office for Police Conduct, but it was deemed there was no wrongdoing in terms of the police officer's actions.
Oh, yeah, this is the shirt from the charity football game.
The family want to raise awareness about the links between ADHD, drug use and suicide.
It's really important that parents understand this and schools understand it and colleges understand it, because they need to know what they could be dealing with. It's not just about the child who can't sit still, it's about the child with mental health problems that could go on to become a suicide risk.
People with ADHD are also more likely to develop substance abuse issues.
Recording videos for social media is one way Henry's brother Tom is hoping to help others with ADHD.
Because of the traits of someone with ADHD, they're branded as naughty. And I think that can spiral really badly, because then if you're branded as naughty, you're treated as a bad person, and that can affect your self-esteem.
He would want us to carry on, and he would want us to make things better for other people, because that's what he always said. I want better understanding in schools so that children are not punished for things that they can't help. I want better support for families.
A campaign to finance ADHD projects in Henry's name has reached over £20,000. The family hope to prevent others going through the emotional devastation of suicide. Heidi Tomlinson, BBC Look North, Rastrick.
Gosh, just heartbreaking. I'm so sorry for their loss. Thank you to the Grierson family for sharing your story with us. Earlier I spoke to Henry Shelford from ADHD UK, who are funding research into the link between ADHD and poor mental health. I began by asking him what difficulties teenagers with ADHD face.
It's a disaster from the get-go. So just getting an ADHD assessment can be, well, the wait lists are up to 5 years, but you've got to get acceptance from your school and doctor as well, and they might not do that. So just getting the assessment is very, very hard. You're not provided support beyond maybe the option of medication, but then there's very little. And then within the school, oftentimes you'll find you're more likely to get excluded than to get the support of an EHCP.
So why are teenagers with ADHD more likely to have poor mental health, or in Henry's situation, take their own life?
It is awful. It's so awful hearing Henry's story and what's happened. And it is the most awful, to compound the awfulness, like, he's not alone, right? 1 in 10 men or boys with ADHD will at some point try and take their own life. 1 in 4 women or girls, 1 in 4. And yet we don't put the support in that for people who are having such an extraordinarily difficult time. They often find themselves really on their own trying to work out what to do. And if you're trying to get urgent mental health care, if there's a crisis, you'll find that the cupboard is really bare. There's very little there to help you. And so you, your family can often find yourself completely struggling on your own.
So Henry, what needs to be done so we don't see more young people falling into crisis?
So the Nuffield Trust came out just a short while ago saying that the ADHD and autism services are not fit for purpose, and they're not. And in schools, the support is not fit for purpose. We surveyed teachers and around 90% said that kids with ADHD in their school are not going to reach their full potential. So we do need to do that full overhaul. We need to understand properly what we're doing right, which is frankly very little, what we're doing wrong, and change it.
Henry Shelfer, thank you. Well, if you have been affected by the issues raised in that discussion, a list of organisations that can help is available at bbc.co.uk/actionline, or you can call for free to hear recorded information on 0800 066 066. A person has died after a mudslide in North Yorkshire this afternoon. Police say emergency services are responding to the incident at Carlton in Cleveland, which happened just after 1 p.m. North Yorkshire Police said that they're monitoring the incident and are asking the public to avoid the area. A man from West Yorkshire has been sentenced to 11 years in prison for drug offences. Faris Zaman was caught on National Crime Agency officers back in July 2020, hiding in his parents' loft in Ashgrove in Bradford. Police said Zaman had been a significant and trusted drug supplier who would supply drugs through an online chat site. A new company has been appointed to run the Alpamare Water Park in Scarborough. It opened in 2016 but was taken over by North Yorkshire County Council last year after the previous operators went into administration. Flamingoland has been the chosen one to take over, with the hope that the park will reopen in time for the summer holidays.
I was brought up in the town from the age of 7, and it's quite well documented that the company Flamingoland was interested in redeveloping the old futurist site. It never came to fruition. And the opportunity presented itself here, and we thought, well, what a great opportunity to move straight in, hopefully get the operation fired up as quickly as possible for the coming summer season.
Now, if you were watching on Monday, you might remember we were talking about Imo Boddy, who was hoping to make history by becoming the fastest woman ever to complete the National Three Peaks Challenge. Well, she smashed it, 420 miles over 6 days. That's the equivalent of 60 marathons back to back. In a moment, we'll speak to Imo, but first, let's take a look at her in action.
We're winning.
Good bar. Winning.
Yeah. Oh. I was in a slight low net before, but feeling better now.
May, it's the fourth day of our three-peak challenge. That's Imo Boddy. This is the summit of Scarborough Pike.
And here she is, a record breaker. Imo, congratulations. How are you feeling?
Exhausted, absolutely exhausted. But yeah, thank you for having me.
Very sore feet as well.
Very
bless you.
Swollen, sore feet.
Yeah, I mean, what an incredible feat. Just talk us through the route, because it's pretty brutal, isn't it? Especially to do it in the time that you did it.
Yeah, so we started in Fort William, sea level in Scotland, hiked Ben Nevis, and then went along the West Highland Way, and then all the way to Scarfell, hiked Scarfell, and then ran all the way to Snowdon, and finished in Carnarvon yesterday at about 12 o'clock.
And how was it? What was the hardest bit for you?
It was absolutely brutal. It was the hardest thing I've ever done, but also the most incredible. I had so much support. There were so many towns and villages that people came out and supported, but equally, absolutely brutal.
Now, you were very much inspired by Anne Sayer, weren't you, who broke the record in 1979. Yes. Tell us a little bit about her.
Yeah, so we actually didn't realise initially she was the one until we did lots of research. She was an Olympian. She actually was a power walker, which was no mean feat, because you can power walk incredibly fast. We set out to break it, and it hasn't been broken since 1979, and for a good reason, because it was absolutely brutal.
What is this all about for you? Why do you put yourself through this?
I think I took quite a lot of time to reflect when we were running, and actually there is so much more to it now than just kind of the record. There's been so much on socials, and so many people have been inspired, and I think that's probably the most important thing for me. I think I had so much trust in my coach as well, and kind of building that relationship. I just think it was a team effort, and I think what it's in for now is just kind of inspiring, and you can achieve so much if you put your mind to it, and I think that's what I realised from this one.
And I have no doubt you have another one up your sleeve, so we look forward to hearing from you when you're well rested. Congratulations.
Thank you.
An amazing achievement.
Thank you.
Now, imagine bagging tickets to see a West End music star perform at your local cricket ground. It sounds more like my thing than Imo's challenge. Well, Almondbury Wesleyan Cricket Club in Huddersfield is rolling out the red carpet as we speak for the one and only Michael Ball. Yes, really. It is safe to say that organisers were a little surprised when he said yes, and now they're struggling to convince some of the locals that he is the real deal.
Michael Ball will be here singing live at 5 o'clock on Sunday the 16th of June, backed by a 10-piece orchestra. Well, people are asking, is it really Michael Ball? And we show them the poster and they do say, well, it looks like him, but it can't be. But it is.
It is actually me coming up there. I heard that people thought it was going to be a tribute act.
Have you been confused with a tribute before? Are there some good ones out there?
Yeah, people have thought I was going to be Michael Bublé, I think.
What was it about Almondbury cricket ground that made you want to perform there?
I think that it's pioneering. You know, if it works, then this could become a regular thing, a regular venue for people. It's a lovely setting. It's a great idea. I love doing open-air gigs. The thought of just, you know, listening to some music, having your picnic, sat on the lawn. There's nothing better as long as it doesn't rain. And if it does rain, who cares?
Have you been to Yorkshire before? We get quite a lot of rain up here, Michael.
I don't think I've ever been there where it hasn't been raining, if I'm perfectly honest with you. I've had some cracking rainstorms in my time. And, this isn't going to happen. I've had it on good authority. It's going to be perfect sunshine and we'll have a special day.
So what can we expect from this gig in June then, Michael?
It's going to be me doing what I do, doing my show. So songs that people will know from musicals I've been in and albums I've made and, a few surprises in there, stuff that people will remember and will create memories for them. We always do a lovely show. I like sending people out feeling better than when they came in. That's always the aim with any show that you do. So I hope they'll enjoy the choices I've made. And they're a good crowd in Yorkshire. I mean, they call a spade a shovel. And if they like you, they really like you.
Yeah, we certainly do call a spade a shovel. And in terms of audience participation, are you up for that as well? Do you like a good sing-along with the crowd, Michael?
Absolutely. If you know the words, sing along, as long as it doesn't annoy anybody around you. Because I tell you where it's bad is actually when you're doing a musical and you're doing a show and someone's singing the show to you and you think, no, that's not how this is meant to work. But in a concert situation in the open air, I think it'll be nice, don't you? Do you sing along, Amy?
Of course I do. That's why I was asking. So put your plugs in if you sat next to me.
So what song is your go-to then?
If I were to sing a song, love changes everything.
I make sure that everyone sings only that line. You're only allowed that line, but everyone sings along that. And well, no one seems to go for the big note at the end.
Funny that. Michael, we'll look forward to seeing you in Yorkshire. Best of luck.
Yeah, see you there, Amy. God bless.
Think you might pull me up for a duet?
What an incredible story.
I love Michael Ball. I'm a massive fan.
I bet those tickets are exchanging hands for thousands on the black market.
I think it'll be a sellout after tonight.
I bet it will be, yeah. You'll have to get a ticket. You'll have to pay this time as well. Right, let's have a look at these pictures. I had to select them from last night because it's been obviously awful today. That was taken near Wakefield. And the second picture was a similar sort of sky. No, it wasn't. That's in Holmfirth. So we've missed that one. But this one was Holmfirth, a bit of green. But it's been, as I say, pretty dreadful. Rainfall figures are very impressive, with Loftus, north of Whitby, having a month's worth of rain since 7 o'clock this morning. So there has been some localised flooding in places. If you've got any pictures, addresses are on your screen right now. So tomorrow's headline is a little bit better, but we have to cover the warnings first, and it's certainly Pennine areas and an amber warning actually for the western extremities of West Yorkshire, so that's something to keep an eye on. It's certainly western parts that will see more rain over the next 6 to 9 hours, courtesy of this area of low pressure, which only gradually moves out of the way. So even by Friday, it's cloudy but mostly dry. As for the weekend, we're still looking at an improvement. There will be some spring sunshine, warm spring sunshine, but also a risk of showers. Now, there's that system that's brought all the rain. It really has been awful across many parts of the region. Bit of a clearance developing across eastern parts now, but it's certainly western areas, some torrential downpours to come. This system will gradually peter out and become fragmented. So eastern areas will become largely dry by dawn. We'll see lowest temperatures around 11 Celsius. That's 52 degrees Fahrenheit. Tomorrow's high water times in Scarborough, 4:45. Bridlington at 5:07. So it's a cloudy day tomorrow. There'll be further patchy rain in places, especially the Pennines, perhaps running through Sheffield into Chesterfield. Further east, a few showers breaking out later, but on the whole, away from the Pennines, there will be a fair amount of dry weather. Quite a cool feel tomorrow for late May. 15 Celsius, the high, with a brisk westerly wind. Very similar tomorrow evening, rather cloudy, scattered showers. I think Friday, mostly dry, rather cloudy. Some warm sunshine at the weekend, but a risk of scattered showers. That's the forecast.
Certainly not weather for outdoor shows or cricket.
No, definitely not.
That is it from us. Phil will be here with your late news with further reaction on the announcement that there will be a general election in 6 weeks' time. But from all of us, good night.